Hello to computational finance and its object-oriented implementation. And this is now our second session on algorithmic differentiation. So we started last session with maybe a bit lengthy motivation where I had a look at a computer program actually to perform a quite simple calculation, which is here. Evaluate this function, yeah, the square root of a squared plus b squared. And we did this by defining an interface that told us what we can do. Then introduced some simple implementation that was just using a floating point number. And then there was another implementation which I did not show to you yet, but which we will see today, that provided an additional function that allowed us to get the derivative of a result with respect to some argument. Yeah? And then we could run this program and see that this algorithm was able to calculate the derivative without a numerical approximation error, except for the rounding error coming from computer arithmetics. So to then discuss this, we needed to introduce a bit of notation. So we were considering that our computer algorithm, so the algorithm that calculates our output value y, is a function of the input values. So as a function of, say, some x0 to xn minus 1, so that our computer algorithm that is a function that generates the output y out of the inputs x0 to n xn minus 1, that this is given by just a sequence, a concatenation of simpler functions xm that depend on some of the previously calculated arguments and then generate an intermediate result xm, yeah, which is then also maybe the argument of the next function. Yeah? And that is, our computer program is actually represented by a sequence of operators. So this is the function fm, which has k superscript m arguments. So this is just the number of arguments. And the arguments that enter into this calculation step is described by this index here. So I j superscript m. So this was the index of the j's argument entering the m's function. Okay, so that was something we just needed for the notation, and we wanted to construct the derivatives, the partial derivatives of the output value with respect to the input values. Okay, and with this notation, we were, for example, able to formulate an iteration, which is just the chain rule that allows to calculate the derivative of a later value, xm, with respect to our input values, xi, given that we have the derivatives of all the earlier values and the dependency of this later value with respect to its arguments. And this was then constituting the forward automatic differentiation, which is just an iterative update of partial derivatives using the chain rule. So very simple, it's just a chain rule. And in the end, your final value, so x capital N, is just y. So you can construct the value that we were looking for. So we can construct this here by just performing an iterative application of the chain rule. And what do we need to apply the chain rule? We need these partial derivatives. And of course, another thing that we need is this guy here telling us what is the argument of the function and telling us then what is the derivative of this value with respect to the input value. So we need some kind of bookkeeping, some kind of storage. But what we do is we propagate the derivative alongside the calculation. Yeah? So as we apply more and more function, we can also propagate the derivatives. So actually, I'm not so much focused here on the forward automatic differentiation, because the forward automatic differentiation is just very similar to what you do with finite differences. Yeah, you in finite differences, you change an input variable, and then you propagate this change to the final value, yeah, and calculate then by the finite difference the derivative. And here, I don't change the input value, but I just propagate the derivative. Yeah? So it's a very simple approach. And actually, it's also from the calculation performance very similar to finite difference. It's only just more accurate because we are doing analytic differentiation. Yeah? So the apart from the rounding error from the machine precision instead of finite difference. And then we had a look at an alternative way. So if I repeat this little picture here, so if here we have our input value x0 and here we have our output value y, so if this algorithm was creating this derivative by using this derivative and multiplying with the dependency of dfm with respect to, in this case, it's just one argument, so dxm minus one, yeah? And then propagating forward, we had an alternative way and just construct the chain rule backward. So that was the picture then that we have here our output value and here our input value, x0. And then this output value is actually the last value we calculate. And if we just have function that depend on one argument, yeah, so xn depends on xn minus one and xn minus one depends on xn minus two. So it's just really an iteration of functions of one argument. Then we could also formulate this idea backward. So this means that we construct this derivative here from here to here by iteratively going backward, knowing this derivative, which is dy by dxm in this equation here, and then multiplying with how does the function that results gives the result xm depend on its argument. So in this formulation, we propagate the derivative backward to the arguments. And in the end, if you go all the steps backward, you have the derivative of y with respect to the input. There is a small drawback in this formulation. You see that here this summation runs over all indices jm such that xr is the jth argument of the function fm. I'm looking at all functions and all arguments of those functions that use a given node. Maybe I draw a little picture here. So if this is your final result, this is an intermediate result, and this is maybe an input value, but this one also depends maybe on that one, and that one depends also on this one, and maybe on this one. Yeah. So then, if you like to calculate now the derivative of the final value, so this here is our final value, with respect to this value. So this here is now your xr. Then this summation means that you search for all m, so all functions, and j, so all arguments, that have xr as an argument. So that means that you are looking actually for this guy and propagate the derivative here, and this guy and propagate the derivative here. So this is actually the summation. So I have two different m's. This one depends on this input, and this one depends on this input, and we propagate it backward. So I need to look, if I'm on this node xr, which function used this argument. Instead of the other formulation, a given function, what are the arguments of this function? This second thing is often much easier, because if you evaluate a function, you know its argument, because otherwise you cannot evaluate the function. So we need to have some storage that allows us to know, given a value, which later functions use this value. And this is a bit cumbersome. So we were looking for an alternative formulation. So to make this a little bit precise, so what this formulation here does is it pulls the derivatives from the dependent node to the argument nodes. So maybe just repeat this little picture here. So that is what it means if I say it pulls the derivative. So we had maybe this example. This one is our output. It depends on that one. This one depends on that one and that one. So this is a function of two arguments. But maybe this one is also a function of two arguments, namely of this input and this one. Okay. And now we pull the, so how did I draw it here, blue, yeah? So we pull the derivatives to this argument node. Yeah. So what are the derivatives? The derivatives are actually the partial derivatives which we observe along these lines. So the derivatives are these guys here, pulled along these lines, and they are pulled from the dependent nodes. So let's draw the dependent nodes here. So these two depend on this value. Okay, so from the dependent nodes. So I pull the derivative down, and this is from a programming perspective maybe a little bit complicated, but we can also make an alternative formulation. So instead we can also push the values from a dependent node to its argument. So how would this look like? So this push, yeah, let's draw the same calculation again. So that one depends on that one, is a function of one argument. This guy here is a function of two arguments, namely of this value and of this value. And this value is a function of two arguments, namely of this value and this value. So now, assume I would like to, I'm in the iteration where I am here. Yeah. So now I'm not at the same point in my iteration. So I am here. So I have already calculated the derivative from the output from the blue one to the output. Yeah. So this partial derivative has been already calculated. Okay. So now I'm at this point. So This means I multiply the partial derivative of y with respect to this value. So this is y with respect to xm. I multiply it with the partial derivative I observe along these lines and push this one. So maybe I draw this one here green. So then it's maybe a bit more consistent. Yeah, so output is green. And push this one to the arguments. Yeah, to the arguments. So multiply the derivative you already know with the partial derivatives along the two lines. So the two different partial derivatives you have, derivative with respect to the first argument, and put this value here and multiply the derivative with the partial derivative along this line and put this value here. Okay, then this node does not yet contain the derivative of y with respect to this node because there's still a step missing. But this second step will happen then later, yeah, when we push the derivatives from here down there and down there. Okay, so it's just a different order of calculating the sum. In the end, you will have here the correct value. So we just process this in a different order. So we push the values from the dependent node to the argument node. And in this case, the algorithm looks like this. So, and that was where we actually ended up in our last session. And now I'd like to prove this theorem here and maybe also discuss the code and advantages and disadvantages we see in the implementation. So this is now the backward automatic differentiation algorithm in a form that is very suitable for our implementation. So actually the implementation will be surprisingly short. Yeah. So that's really cool. So how does this work? So we define the values D0 up to D capital N by the following backward induction. We initialize D capital N to 1 and all the other values to 0. And then I iterate backward over M from capital N to little n. So actually this M is now the node here in my calculation. So I iterate backward from the last value that has been calculated to the value that has been calculated before. And maybe that value has been calculated then before that, and maybe then we propagate here. Yeah? So we propagate backward through the ordering of our operators. And then for each function, I just need to look at the arguments. So then for all arguments, iterating through the argument list. So this is a nice thing here. For this, we need to know the arguments, just the arguments of the functions. So what are the arguments of function M? This is the question. And this is something we can easily store while we performing the evaluation. Yeah? So what were the arguments of the function? So we iterate through all functions. We just have a list of all functions we have evaluated, and then we iterate through all the arguments. So that is a very natural order. And then we just perform the following update rule, DYJM. So the derivative with respect to the node corresponding to the argument is set to its previous value plus the derivative of this node of this function multiplied with the partial derivative of the function with respect to its argument. So that is exactly what was meant with push the derivative from the dependent node to the argument. Okay, so this here is push the partial derivative multiplied with the DM, yeah, so with the derivative which we already know in our node, to the argument. Note, yeah, so that will be the dij superscript m, yeah, the j's argument of the m's function. So now the claim is, if we do this in this natural order, then the value dm agrees with the partial derivative of y with respect to xm for all m. So for all m means also for all our x0 to x little n minus 1, so for our input nodes. So actually this algorithm calculates much more. Yeah? So this algorithm not only calculates the derivative of the output value with respect to the input values here, it also calculates all partial derivative, this one with respect to this one with respect to this one. Okay, so now maybe we have to clarify a little bit the notation. So what does it mean that so maybe I draw a little box here. So what is actually dy by dxm if m is a dependent variable. Yeah, so what does it mean? So maybe we have to clarify a little bit the notation. So for m larger than n, the value xn is a dependent variable. And what is meant here by dy by dxn? So for example, consider the following thing. X1 is just the identity operator mapping x0 to x1, yeah, identity function. And x2 is x1 minus x0. So if x0 is your input and x2 is your output, the derivative of x2 with respect to x0 is zero, yeah? Because it actually x2 is always zero. Yeah? So this means dy, so this here is our y, by dx0 is zero. So what is actually dy by dx1? Yeah, so if x1 is the same than x0, then is it also zero? No, this is not what the algorithm will calculate. And to illustrate what the algorithm calculates, we actually can illustrate this very nicely in a debugger. Yeah? So before I continue with this slide, let me make this illustration what this algorithm is actually calculating. So let me move here to Eclipse and I create a small little program, really a ultra trivial program. Let's call this operator tree experiment. and I would like to have a main function so I can run a little program. And let's just calculate the stuff that I just wrote there. So let's have some input value, yeah, say 10. And then I define a new variable, and that should be the same as x zero. And then I define my output value, my y, so as x2 is equal to x1 minus x zero. And let's print the value which we just calculated. So let's print the x2. Okay, so if you run this little program here, so run is a Java application. So let's run, yeah. So you see the output is, of course, 10 minus 10 is 0. Yeah. And if you change here the value, yeah, so you see the output is always 0. So I expect the derivative of x2 with respect to x1, x0, sorry, to be 0. So, but now let's start a debugger. So let's stop here and let's check what the computer is actually doing. So I can run here the debugger. So I see now that the program is at this location. And if I press here this button, he will perform the calculation. And you see here that he has calculated the x zero, which is 10. Yeah. So let's move to the next step. Yeah, and you see he has defined x1, which is also 10, and then he calculates the difference, which is 0, and he prints it. Okay, so let's do this again, this little exercise. Yeah, so we run here to x0, yeah, and define it as being 10, so this is our input value. Next thing is we define x1. Okay, so and now I consider the program as being stopped. And I see that everything that comes now after this point is a function of x0 and x1. Okay, it is a function of x0 and x1. So I can at this point interpret these two guys as independent variables. And actually the debugger allows me to change this value. Yeah? So this is what debugging is good for. Yeah, you can play a little bit around and I can change this value. And now the program continues to run. So actually this combination here, x0, x1 is inconsistent. Yeah, it doesn't happen in the program usually, but at this point I can make the past to have this change and now check what is the program calculating in this situation. So, and now let's go on. And I see that now x2 is 1 and it prints 1. So obviously the derivative of x2 with respect to x1, given that x0 does not change, is 1. So here the derivative of y with respect to x1 is 1. Because this is a partial derivative, assuming that the other values do not change. And the only thing we have to make precise in our notation is to mention what is the other values. So this is now made precise here on the slide. So given that we have calculated the values from x0 to xm, so we are at the point where we have evaluated the function fm, then we can interpret the successive calculations fm plus 1 to fn as a single function of these arguments. And I call this single function, I call it now f superscript m. So f superscript m is now a function that depends on x0 to xm. So it depends on everything that has been calculated before. So, and all these are now independent. And now I can make precise what is meant by this partial derivative in this algorithm, dy by dxm is how does this function capital F superscript M, so the function that interprets the result as a function of all the previous values, depend on this value xm. And this is actually what this algorithm calculates. It calculates all the intermediate partial derivatives in this sense. Okay, and the intuition behind this is very nicely understood by looking at what you can do with a debugger by changing the previous values and then look at what the output does. Okay, so now we have made precise a little bit the notation here in this algorithm. So maybe one other remark, I will now prove that this is correct. Yeah, the proof is quite easy. It's just the chain rule. But you could also ask yourself, okay, is this really the same as written here? Yeah, so is the push and the pull formulation really the same? Well, assuming that this theorem is correct, you immediately see this. Yeah. So this here, what you see there, so the number 63 is equivalent to our formulation. So where was that? Our formulation here. So let's call this star. Yeah. It has a number. Let's call it 62. Is equivalent to 62. Because what you have here is just a summation. Yeah. The new value is the previous value plus something. This is how we calculate in a computer program a sum. So we are actually calculating dij superscript m is a sum. Okay, and what are we summing? We are summing dm, so a later value, multiplied with the partial derivative fm with respect to xij superscript m. Okay, this partial derivative is only different from zero if xij superscript m is an argument of the function. Otherwise, the derivative is zero because the function does not depend on this xij superscript m. Yeah. So this here means that I'm only going over all arguments. Yeah, so this means I go over all J and M, over all arguments. So if this backward propagation is correct, I can plug in this relation here. So I see that the DM is actually just the DY by DM. And this here is the DFM with respect to xij superscript m. Okay, and now the only thing is that we introduced here a parameter r, so we called this r. So this means that our sum here runs over all I make this red here, yeah? So this index here is an r. So our sum here runs over all ij superscript m equal to r. So, and this is exactly the formulation which we had. So this is exactly the formulation which we had here. Yeah. So dy by xr is the sum over all indices ij superscript m equal to r, and then this product. Okay, so you see that actually this is the same formulation. But for us, it's now enough to prove that this theorem holds, because this is also the algorithm that we will implement. And it is a very nice and simple one, yeah? So we have a simple update rule, and in the end, we know all partial derivative of the output with respect to all intermediate values and all input nodes. Okay, so that was the clarification of the notation. So remember, our notation is that we have a function fm So we have a function here, fm, which we interpret as the result seen as depending on all the values from x0 to xm. So all the values that have been calculated up to step m. Yeah. So after step m. So remember this notation. So with our notation that y can be seen as this function fm depending on x0 to xm, we can now apply a substitution here, and we substitute the value xm by how is xm calculated. Xm is calculated in the m step of our program by the function fm. So xm is calculated by the function fm, and it depends on these arguments here. So we can substitute this value xm here by this function. And then on the right-hand side, you see that I have used the function fm, but what I have on the right-hand side now depends only on x0 to xm minus 1, because I have substituted xm. So actually this expresses now the result as a function of all values from x0 to xm minus 1. It may be, of course, that xm minus 1 doesn't appear here in this sum, in this argument list, but this is not an issue. This just means that the function, which is here on the left-hand side, doesn't depend on xm minus 1, so the derivative with respect to xm minus 1 would be 0. The important thing is that I have removed the dependency on x little m by expressing x little m through its earlier values, x I 1 superscript m to x I k superscript m. So this gives me now a relation between our function fm, which we interpret as the result as a function of all previous values, and the function fm minus 1. So then I can just apply the chain rule to this equation. So if I apply the chain rule to this equation and I can differentiate with respect to all x0 up to xm minus 1, because these are the arguments which could occur on the left-hand side and could occur on the right-hand side, then we just get this result. So this is just the chain rule here. So we just get the chain rule here. The derivative of the left-hand side with respect to xi is the derivative of fm with respect to xi, because xi does maybe appear here as an argument, but also the xm depends on xi. So I have to check, is there an argument ij superscript m equal to I, so fm depending on xi, multiplied with the derivative of fm with respect to xm, the last argument. Okay, so now we have this number 64 here, which is just the chain rule between these functions that interpret the result as depending on different input values. And it gives us a relation of these functions with respect to each individual step. Yeah, so each individual step adds a dependency by expressing a node as a dependent from the independence. Yeah? So each step adds more dependence. So now the result of this algorithm, yeah. So maybe also note that this number 64 is more or less exactly our rule which we have here. Yeah. This gives us now the result by backward induction over all iterations which we perform. So backward induction over M. So the claim is that after the iteration M, so this means since we go backward, after N minus M minus one iterations, yeah, so the N minus M plus one's iteration. Yeah, so if little m is equal to capital N, it's the first iteration. After we have completed the iteration with index M, we have that the value di for all I smaller than m contains the derivative of this function f superscript m minus one with respect to xi. Okay, this looks a little bit strange. So for all I smaller than m, this should be the partial derivative. Yeah. Huh? So this is a bit strange because this guy is y. So this means after the first iteration, I have all derivatives. Okay, so now this is now important. Yeah, this is the little issue with our notation. This is now important how we interpret this function. So let's look what's happening here by drawing a small tree. Yeah, so here we have our output value. Okay, so this value depends maybe on that value, on that value and that value. So it's a function of three arguments. Maybe this guy depends on this value and this value. And this guy just depends on this value. And this one depends maybe here on this. Yeah. So we have many inputs and one output. So now in the first iteration, it is that I interpret all the guys here as independent nodes. All those are now independent. So it is like the quay lines are not there. Yeah. And now I look, how does the green dot depend on these values? And there are only three values that enter into this green dot, these three values. So after the first iteration, the derivative with respect of the output value with respect to this value is zero. Because the partial derivative means the derivative of this value with respect to this value, assuming that this value remains constant. So if you change it here, yeah, and that one remains constant, it will not affect the result. So this is in your debugger, yeah. If you change this value here, but this value has already been calculated, it will never enter into this value. So it is a little bit as if the quay lines are not there. Yeah? So these lines are not there. So, and this is what our value di contains after the first iteration step. It is the derivative of the output value with respect to all the input values, assuming that all the input values are independent. And then you see that the last step only depends on these three. Then you move one step further. So maybe the next node which you process is this dark blue one here. And now you process this one, depends on that one and that one. So now the dark blue one becomes a dependent node. And you view the green one, now the dark green one, as a function of the light blue blue ones. Yeah, so maybe I make this one here, let's say black. Yeah, so it's no longer blue. Okay, so it's now a function of these guys here. This one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, this one. Okay, and this one has become a dependent variable. And now you see the derivative of the output value with respect to this one is still zero, yeah? Because there's no way that this enters. Because if you change this value, but you keep this value constant, it has no effect. Yeah? But now if you change this value, this one is a dependent variable. It's calculating and it's entering. So this is how this here on the left-hand side has to be interpreted, that the DI contains the derivative. Oh, this is so ugly here. So let's make this go away. So this is that the DI is the derivative of fm minus one. Yeah, so we have executed step m, then it's the derivative of the function that depends on x0 to xm minus one, the function that depends on all the others with respect to xi. Okay. So actually we have to prove this red box. Yeah, but this red box is easy to see. It follows from backward induction. Yeah. So for m equals n, this follows from the initialization. If all the quay lines have been vanished, then I just have the output node as a function of the output node, the derivative is one. And then the backward step is just what we have seen here. Yeah? So the backward step is that we propagate the derivative into the argument node. Yeah? So this follows just from 64. And all the other nodes are still independent. Yeah? So it's maybe not yet the derivative which we are looking for. Yeah? There could be still some values missing. But then there comes a second observation. The DI is no longer modified once we have passed with the iteration the index I. Yeah. So the DI is not modified if we are at iteration m and m is smaller or equal I. So why is that the case? Okay, so why is that the case? Because we only look at arguments entering into the function. Yeah, these are the arguments entering into the function fm. Okay, and if we are that m is smaller than I, we know that all argument indices have to be smaller than m. Yeah, a function cannot depend on a value that has not been yet calculated, that is calculated after it. So a function can only depend on x i's where the I is smaller than the function. So hence the DI is not updated anymore once we have passed the iteration has passed the index I. Yeah? So the iteration m is smaller or equal I. So this means that the value does not change after that. So it means the value that remains in the dm for all values is then the derivative of the function fm with respect to its last argument xm. So this is what we have here. So this means that dm is the derivative of the output value if you interpret the output value as a function of x0 to xm with respect to this xm. Okay, then if we are finally done with it, so all the other dependencies here have been cut, have been propagated, there are no more iterations to do. And in the leaf nodes, so in the input nodes, we then finally find the derivative which we were looking for. So this is here the special case that M is smaller than N minus one, or so that M has arrived at N minus one. Then we have the derivative for with respect to our leaf nodes. Okay, so that was the proof that this iteration gives us all partial derivatives of the output with respect to the input nodes, and it gives us even more, all partial derivatives with respect to all intermediate results in a certain sense. In this sense, if we interpret these partial derivatives in this sense. Okay, so of course you are maybe now curious, how does the implementation look like of this? And it will follow in a few minutes. So what is the time now? Yeah, we still have time in a few minutes, and the implementation will be amazingly short. But before I discuss the implementation, let me maybe compare the two algorithms. So I had a small focus here on the backward automatic differentiation, because that is the one which is for us maybe more relevant in applications. And the forward automatic differentiation is just maybe very classical how you apply the chain rule. Yeah, a new output is created from the inputs. And the two behave very differently with respect to calculation performance, so speed, and also storage requirements. And to illustrate this, let me shortly go through this by looking at two examples. So my examples are just graphical representations. So usually I denote my input nodes with x0, x1, and so on. So here I started with x1, but okay, if that confuses you, you could think that the programmer had another value here, x0, and he doesn't use the value. Okay, then you have another input node here. So, and that's now our computer program. So our computer program has two inputs, x1 and x2. x3 is a function of x1, x5 is a function of x2, x4 is a function of x3, x6 is a function of x5, and then x7 is a function of two arguments, namely x4 and x6. And what we like to calculate is the derivative of the output, which is x7, with respect to the inputs x1 and x2. So how does forward iteration work? So we initialize the derivative of x1 with respect to x1 to 1. Yeah? So this is how we initialize the algorithm. And then we propagate this derivative through the operator tree by applying the chain rule. So the derivative of x3 with respect to x1 is x3 with respect to x1 multiplied with this one. So this is just multiplying with the derivative we see along this line. Yeah. So the derivative we see along this line here is dx3. So in our notation, it is f3 with respect to x1. Okay, so then we know the derivative dx3 with respect to x1. Then to get x4 with respect to x1, so dx4 by dx1, we multiply dx4 by dx3. Yeah? So this is here the derivative dx4 by dx3. So we just know the derivative of this one with respect to its previous node. We multiply it with the derivative which we have already calculated in the previous step. Yeah. So this guy here goes here. Yeah, so this is our previous step. And now this goes on. So the next step is that we get dx7 by dx1 by multiplying the partial derivative, which we see along this line here. So this is dx7 by dx4. So actually I should draw it in red. That's not a big issue. So this is dx7 by dx4. So this is the partial derivative, which we know. We just know always the partial derivatives to the next arguments, the arguments entering into the creation of the value with the previous value. Okay, so we plug in here, this value is then just everything which we see here. And then we are done and we have x7 with respect to x1. And we do the same now for the other argument. We initialize dx2 by dx2 with 1 and we propagate the derivative up to the final node dx7 by dx2. And you see, I need 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 calculation steps to calculate the partial derivatives. Okay. So that was the forward iteration. Now look at the same example doing backward iteration. So that is actually the algorithm which we had on the slide. We initialize the final node here with 1. So we initialize the output node dx7 by dx7 is 1. And we propagate the derivative now down to the arguments. So dx7 by dx4 is 1 multiplied with dx7 by dx4. So this propagates the derivative down. Then we take the derivative, which we already know, dx7 by dx4, and multiply it with dx4 by dx3 to get the derivative dx7 by dx3. And we propagate this down. So finally, we have dx7 with respect to dx1 is the derivative dx7 dx4 multiplied with dx4, dx3 multiplied with dx3 by dx1. Okay, and we do the same, the other route, propagate the derivatives down to finally get the two partial derivatives dx7 with respect to dx1 and dx7 with respect to dx2. Yeah. And you see that we have the same number of calculations. So actually, we have the same number of calculations because every step is just a line in this graph, and both algorithms had just the same number of lines. Yeah. So there were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 lines here. So I had to multiply 6 partial derivatives, either forward or backward. Okay, so now let's have a look at another example, namely this example. So let me go through this a little bit more quicker. I like to calculate the value of the derivative dx5 with respect to dx1 and dx5 with respect to dx2. So forward iteration, we propagate the derivative of x1 with respect to x1, which is equal to 1, to the next node, gives us dx3 by dx1, to the next node, gives us dx4 by dx1, to the next node, gives us dx5 by dx1. So we have the partial derivative. And also note that this is exactly the same thing that you would do by bump and revalue, so by finite differences. So by finite differences, you would change the value x1 and keep the value of x2 being the same. Then you would perform the calculation up to the top. So now for the second partial derivative, dx5 by dx2, I initialize dx2 by dx2 by 1, and I propagate this partial derivative along the calculation. So I get dx3 by dx2, I get dx4 by dx3, and I get dx5 by dx4. And this is also what you do in a finite difference. In a finite difference, you would keep x1 stays the same, x2 is modified. Yeah? So you have function of x1 and x2 plus epsilon minus function of x1 and x2, yeah? In a finite difference. So you modify x2 and you propagate the value through the operator tree up to the output. Note that if you do it like that, Yeah. Then here in this calculation, for example, in this last step, we multiply here x5 by x4 with the stuff we have observed previously, dx4 by dx3, dx3 by dx2. And here we multiply dx5 by dx4 with the stuff that we have observed previously. Oops. But these two things are not the same. Okay, so they are not the same because there is this guy. No? So they are not the same. So it is that if you go for the dx5, dx1, you modify x1 and keep the value x2 unmodified in the finite difference. Yeah. And if you would like to calculate the derivative with finite difference, dx5 by dx2, yeah, you modify the x2 and keep the x1. Yeah. So it's a partial derivative. So it's a different combination in the input values that gives you the output value. And maybe on the way, yeah, there's a lot of change. So let's have a look at this example in the backward iteration, and there lies suddenly a small difference. So for the backward iteration, I like to calculate x5 by x1 and dx5 by x2. I initialize the output value, dx5 by dx5 to 1, and I propagate this backward down. So I get dx5 by dx4, dx5 by dx3, okay, and now I propagate this derivative dx5 by dx3 to the argument and get dx5 by dx1. But now observe that if I would like to calculate the partial derivative x5 with respect to x2, I could just reuse the value which we have just calculated and multiply it just with a different partial derivative, namely the dx3 by dx2, and get the derivative dx5 by dx2 by just a single additional line. Yeah? One additional step. Okay, so while for the forward, it looks as if I have to do everything twice, yeah. So, except from the first triangle, all the stuff on the top comes twice. Here, I touch every line only once. Okay. And the reason is because I have one output and many inputs. So, actually, it would be the opposite. If we have many outputs, but only few inputs or one input, then it's actually the opposite. And then forward propagation has an advantage. But this is clear. If you have just one input and you perform a forward propagation and you have many outputs, then you see the result on the outputs. But this thing is that with backward, we have it in the other direction. If we have just one output and many inputs, I can get all partial derivatives of the output with respect to all inputs in a single sweep, in a single run. And usually we have many inputs in our model, but maybe just one output, the value of the financial derivative. And this is the reason why I have a focus here on the backward iteration, because it is very relevant for us. So the backward is much more efficient if you have a function that has just one or few output values, depending on many input values. Okay. So this efficiency can be actually proven in a theorem. So figure 34 and 35, so what we have just looked at, this illustrates that forward propagation and backward propagation behaves quite differently, yeah, with respect to performance. And this performance depends on the number of input and the number of output values. So if you assume that we have here functions of real numbers generating real numbers, so assume that we have a function from Rn to Rm. So actually in our example, m was equal to 1. Yeah. So we had just had n input nodes and one output node. But if it is now a general function from Rn to Rm, then you can show that if the value t subscript f is the time required to evaluate our function f, then the forward mode, so the forward automatic differentiation, requires the time n times tf, so number of input nodes multiplied with the time required to evaluate the function once. So this is actually also what you would expect from a finite difference. Yeah, change one input node and recalculate everything. Change another input node and recalculate everything. So you need n times the time of recalculating everything. But for the backward iteration, the dependence is number of output nodes, m, multiplied with the time required to calculate the whole function. Yeah. So this is maybe here a surprise. Yeah. This depends on m, scales with m, and this here scales with n. Yeah. So number of input nodes, number of output nodes. So actually this means in our application, where m is equal to 1, I can calculate all first order partial derivatives of this function just by an algorithm that requires as much time as it requires to calculate the function once. So assume you have a mathematical model that depends on 400 input values and generates one output value. A finite difference would require 400 times the time to calculate the function to get all partial derivatives. And this algorithm just requires once the evaluation of the function to get all partial derivatives. So this is a massive improvement in speed. Okay, can we prove this? Actually, the proof is quite trivial if you make the corresponding assumption. So the assumption is that our update rule, so this here is our update rule. Our update rule just requires the same computation time as the function fm would require. So remember that our update rule is a sum, a plus, a multiplication of a previous derivative multiplied with the partial derivative. So maybe we can forget about the plus and the multiplication. So this assumption is just that the partial derivative of m is of fm is as complicated as the function itself. Okay, and maybe that this is a reasonable assumption, yeah? So because fm are just very simple functions, exponential derivative is also the exponential logarithm, yeah, derivative is 1 divided by x. So maybe this is a reasonable function. And if you have this property, and you have the property that the number of arguments is bounded, because our update rule has to be performed for every argument. So if you consider just functions of one argument, two arguments, three arguments, and your computer program is built all of these functions, then this is three times the value to calculate the function. So it's order value to calculate the individual function fm. Yeah? So very, very, very obvious that our algorithm has this performance characteristic. And again, the remark for our case of a function that has many inputs, n inputs, and one outputs, this means that we can calculate all partial derivatives in just order tf. Okay, so that is, wow, an amazing algorithm. Okay. Yeah, so now let's have a look at the implementation. So here is maybe a little surprise. We can implement this in, say, 10 lines of code. Yeah? And before I look at the slides, let's just look at Eclipse and have a look at the implementation which we have here. So remember that we expressed our calculations using a special interface value. So this interface value, if you look at it, it just tells us what operations can be done. So this interface here is the definition of the set of functions F subscript M that can be applied. Yeah? So we can apply only a very limited set of functions. You can make this larger, if you like. And then we implemented these functions. For example, we had this value double. So maybe I make this debugger here go away. So we have a little bit more screen space here. And you can, and we have implemented this function. For example, the square just takes the value and multiplies it with it itself and then generates a new class representing this value. So this was maybe just a wrapper around a classical floating point number, a double. So we implemented all these functions here. Okay, so what do we have to do for our code? For our backward automatic differentiation, also called a joint automatic differentiation. So the first thing we have to do is to perform some tracking. We need to remember which function is executed and what are the arguments. So to do this, we implement something like this here, but before we calculate the but when we calculate the result, we also remember what was the argument and what was the function we executed. So this is here our value double differentiable. And we define an enumeration, which is just a list of operators we can do. So what operators are possible here? So we can do squared, square root, plus, minus, multiplication, division, okay? And we need some storage to store which operator was used and what was the argument. And we store this in every value. So every value, so this is just now the node in your little tree. Every value now knows in addition to its value, so this here is the same as we did here. In addition to this, we store what was the operator that was used. So this is just one of these. And what was the list of arguments that was used. And I also store the ID, which is the number of this operations. Yeah? So this is the little m in the X superscript m. So I need this ID later because I need to go backward in the correct order. So I need to know what is the ID. So at which iteration was this value created? And to calculate this ID here, we use the so-called atomic long. Yeah? So there is here the next ID. This is the next ID that will be used. This is a static variable. So this is like a singleton. It exists in the whole program only once. It is the same value for all classes. It is when you perform a calculation, this is the next value for the ID to be used for this node. So, and instead of having a constructor, like here, that constructs this class from a double value, I now construct this class here from a value by remembering the operator that was used and remembering the arguments. And I just set the value of the ID to this next ID by issuing this get, and then this increment will automatically count up. So this here is generating the xn, xn plus one, xn plus two. Yeah. So this is again generating the indices. Okay, so that's actually all I need to store the information. And then comes very boring code that whenever you perform a squared, yeah, perform the calculation, but also remember what you did and what was the argument. So if I calculate squared, the argument is just this node. So this is just list of this. But I remember that the result, which is a new result, was generated by x squared. So this new result here, this here jumps into the constructor, then has the right value. This new result here knows that it is generated by the function x squared. And this new result here has a reference to the argument, which is this here. So this is the argument and the new result is the new value. Okay, so maybe have a look here at add. Yeah? If we perform a plus operation between two nodes, then this here is one node plus the other node. One node is this, the left-hand side of the plus, and the other node is the x, the right-hand side of the plus. Yeah? So this method here add adds another value, which is x, to this node. Yeah? So this applies a plus x to this object a. This is my comment. Okay, so that means perform the calculation, but also remember that the result was created by plus operator, and also remember the two arguments. So you see that actually there is not even one additional line. Yeah, it's just a different line for each operator, which just remembers what we did. Yeah. This is quite trivial. And this is then just filling for every node in the tree this dependency. Also, you see that my tree is quite local. Yeah, so every node only knows what are your arguments and what is your number. Yeah? It doesn't know the remainder of the whole tree. Okay, it's enough to know what is your value, what was the operator that created this value, and what are the arguments. Okay, so that is all we need to do for the topic of tracking. Okay, and then comes the core algorithmic differentiation algorithm, which is just 10 lines of code. So if you don't believe it, let's have a look at these 10 lines of code now. It's here. So this is what we do when we like to calculate the derivative of a node with respect to, okay, and since the algorithm can calculate all partial derivatives with respect to all nodes, let's calculate just all. So what I will calculate is actually a map of derivatives where the argument of this map is the node xi and the value double is the dy by dxi. Okay, so what I calculate here is all partial derivatives of the output node or of the node where you ask this for with respect to all arguments. So I will construct the map that calculates everything in a single run. Of course, for convenience, there's also somewhere here the method get derivative with respect to a specific value. But this is just the same as calculating get derivative with respect to all value, and then asking for what is the value for this specific value. And if this value is not in this map, there is no dependency, then it's zero. Okay, so let's have a look here at this again. And this algorithm has just 10 lines. Yeah. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and then the value is returned. Okay, it has just 10 lines. Okay, so how do we do this? I want to construct a mapping that contains for every node in my tree the value of the derivative. So let's create this mapping and create first an empty map. Okay. So I know that the derivative of dy with respect to dy is 1. So actually this here is our initialization. We initialize dy by dy to 1. So let's put this into this. This is then our mapping. So this map here is actually the derivatives of our capital Fm with respect to xi. And then in every iteration, this becomes capital Fm minus 1 with respect to all xi's, and then capital Fm minus 2 with respect to all xi's, and so on. Yeah? So this map here is actually in our script. The map contains in iteration m the values d f superscript m minus 1 by d x I. So actually this is the map which we are calculating here. So in the first iteration, we know that dy by dy is 1, and I put this derivative here. And now I will iteratively update this map by propagating our update rule. So in order to perform this update, I have to know which nodes I have to look at. And I always have to look at the nodes that are the arguments. So what are the arguments of this node? Okay. So this means that I need some kind of storage, which nodes I have to look at in the future iteration. So this is here a set. It's a set of nodes, which just contain these nodes, which I create here. And I will comment on this set in a few seconds again. So let's just consider this as a set. So then add the current node, so your output node, to this set, which means you have to look at this node. And now the algorithm goes through all these nodes. So while there is still a node inside this set, so while this is not empty, remove this node from the set. So poll last is get the node, which is the current node, and then do the update rule. So now this here is our update rule. So the update rule means get all arguments of this current node. So I ask for the arguments. So this get arguments just gives me here this list of arguments. So see, this is here below. Get arguments gives me just a list of arguments. So then I have a list of all arguments, and then perform our update rule by propagating the derivative of the current node to the arguments by updating this map. Okay, so actually I cheated a little bit with 10 lines. There is a function here which I'm calling, which is here below, but I will have a look at this in a few seconds. And then we have propagated all the derivatives down to the arguments. So I need to add the arguments to our set of nodes, which we have to process. So I removed the output, but all the input that entered into this output have been added to this set. And now it's important that we walk through our list of results of output nodes in descending order. Yeah. So this poll last will get the last value of a set that is sorted ascending by their ID. And if you like to have a set here in Java that is sorted, then you can create something which is called a comparator. And this comparator here, you see, it is just comparing the two IDs. Yeah. So this set here is actually sorted by ID. Okay. So this means that when I remove a node from this set, I'm always removing the node with the highest value. And then I add all the arguments. So for example, if the last node depends on x0, x3, and x5, he will put this into the set, but the next node that is polled is x5 because it is the node with the highest argument. And then x5 maybe depends on x2 and x4. So x4 is put into the set, and in the next iteration, he is pulling x4. And then he has x3, x2, x0, x1 maybe in the set, and he is going downward in the right order. So actually this line here is a little bit important. This here ensures that all the nodes we are putting there are ordered according to their ID. And this here is that we always remove or always get the topmost. And since the leaf nodes don't have arguments, in the end, the set will be empty because we will remove nodes, but they have no arguments. Okay, so and what is this propagate derivatives to arguments doing? It is just calculating our update rule. The new derivative is the old derivative multiplied plus multiplying the derivative from the current node with the partial derivative. So the partial derivative of a sum, z is x plus y, dz by dx is 1. Z is x plus y, dz by dy is 1. Yeah. The partial derivative of a difference, x minus y, dz by dx is 1. Dz by dy is minus 1. Okay, and this is the partial derivative of a product, x times y. The partial derivative dz by dx is just y. So I multiply with the argument y for the first partial derivative and with the argument x for the second partial derivative. And this here is the squared. Oh, actually, I forgot the division. Oh, maybe I have to fix this. So actually in my algorithm, the division wasn't used. So that was why it didn't show up. And the square root. Okay, oh, I have to fix this here. So you see that there is a little bit more code. There is for every operator, you have one line per operator and argument that calculates the derivatives. So there is a little bit of additional code, one line per operator and argument to calculate the partial derivatives. But it's very few code. Okay, so that was the backward automatic differentiation, yeah? So just a small code that fits on a single page here. Yeah? And now we have to still discuss a few small design issues with this code, which we will do next time. But here on the slides, you find again the code. Yeah, so maybe I just complete this slide here. Yeah. So maybe I have a limit, 1 minute left. So that's the code which we have just looked at. So I create some map here where we store. This here is the mapping. Xi maps to df superscript m by dxi in every iteration, yeah, in the iteration capital N and so on. Yeah. So then we initialize this. Let's see, we initialize here the root node to 1, dxy by dxy is 1. Then we set up a list of all nodes which we have to process here. So this is an ordered set. We add the root node to it. So this is here. And then while this list is not empty, we take the topmost node, the node with the highest ID. This will ensure that it's ordered. I have a look at this in the next session. And then we propagate the derivatives through the argument nodes down. Look at where are the arguments, put the derivatives down. So update this mapping here. And then add the arguments to your list of nodes, which you have to look at. And we have, for every operator, we have a code that performs this update rule. Okay, so I have another code session in the next session, but maybe one last argument here, or one last remark. The code here is actually much more efficient than the one which we had on the slide, because the code only touches those nodes that enter into the result. Yeah? So if you have, for example, a computer program that looks like this, this is the result which depends on that value, and that value, and then this depends on this value. But here there was maybe some calculation performed that created a different result. Yeah? And you are now asking, okay, what is the derivative of this value here with respect to these two values? Then the algorithm just propagates along these lines here. So it, this one, and then it adds this node, this one, this one, and it doesn't care about those nodes that did not enter. Yeah? So this is because we always here add the arguments, and we do not look at things that are not arguments. Okay, so that was it for today. And we have a little more on code next session, and then we will start with stochastic algorithmic differentiation. Thank you.